tuning in to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans. Producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows. Interviewing celebrities and showrunners. And bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hey there, Z Nation fans. Welcome to another edition of the AfterBuzz Recap Show. Tonight we are talking about episode 11, Sisters of Mercy. How are y'all doing tonight?
I'm doing good. I always feel like with the theme, I should be wearing a cowboy hat like at all times yeah. with a gun to pull out.
Like you're in a spaghetti western.
Like I said, there was an episode a few weeks ago where the musical cue to me just felt like Land of the House of the Rising Sun.
It was a
spaghetti western, but I kept expecting it to become that song, and it never was.
Not quite. That's the good, the bad, and the ugly, isn't it?
That is awesome. But
that is not the episode we got this week.
We do have a crazy episode tonight, an emphasis on crazy because there are a lot of crazy people in the house. But let me go ahead and introduce our panel before we talk about all those crazy people. Joining me, Katie Cullen.
Hi, all my buddies.
Representing for Team Survival, Zach Wilson.
We will survive. Roya, she's on ice. She'll be back to help us survive. Unlike you guys who are not helpful towards furthering the cause of survival.
I'm sorry.
We're still here.
Yeah, we're doing
all
right.
For now.
And joining us, we've got a couple very special guests in the studio with us tonight. We have the writer for this episode, Jen Derwingson. How are you tonight?
I'm good, thanks. Thanks for having me back.
Thank you for joining us again. You came back.
I came back, yeah. You didn't terrorize me enough the first time, so.
Oh, we'll fix that this time.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And we have the director of this episode as well, Rachel Goldenberg.
Hello, happy to be here.
And we have the editor for this episode, Erik C. Anderson.
Here I am.
So we basically have the people who put together this show.
All phases, beginning, middle, and end.
Yeah,
in terms
really
of production.
Much. Mm-hmm. So before we go through recapping the episode, just from all of you guys, what were your guys' thoughts working on this episode? Because you do all work in different stages of the production. How was each of yours approach to this episode?
Well, and this was an idea that I originally pitched in the writer's room back when we started. It wasn't always a cult. I think it's enough just that women want to get together for self-protection. And once we saw the location where we shot the compound, we were like, you don't really need a lot of persuasion to stay here. But I think in the world of Z Nation, whatever people have to do to survive usually takes them to some extreme. And I think that's what ended up happening with the all-female compound that they come across. But there were a lot of things that happened during production that added, you know, a lot to what I originally conceived, and especially bringing in Kelly McGillis, which was a real honor for us to have her on the show.
Yeah. Was she Sister Helen?
She was Helen, yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm curious, as you came up with it in the room, was it, did you start with the idea of the compound and then sort of build the Mac and Addie plotline into it? Or is that where they were first and then you built in this plotline as a...
No, it was originally, you know, how we came up with the episodes was we had our map of where they were going across the country, and when they were going to get there. And then we kind of matched up the episode ideas that we had pitched, not knowing where, you know, when we originally pitched the episode idea, like cannibals or, you know, all women, we didn't know exactly where they were going to be in the course of the season. And so when we decided where to put this episode, then it became, all right, well, where are the characters in terms of their own character arcs, and how does this fit in, and what can we do here with our characters in this particular place with these particular characters?
Cool.
I like it. Now, from a directorial standpoint, because you clearly want to show that something is amiss with all this wonderful perfect, because never trust anybody too nice, as Warren puts it. How was going about putting that kind of Stepford, there's not something quite right feeling about this place?
I think, like you said, it was kind of the fact that it's idyllic is how you know that it's bad. So it wasn't necessarily trying to infuse evil as so much as, this is the only episode that I've done because I directed it. So I just came in for this one, but I was familiar with all the rest of the season and I knew how different this setup was than the rest. So it was just servicing, you know, this happy place that, you know, if you're going to lose a main character to this place, it has to have a lot of things that you would want to be around. So it wasn't so much trying to infuse creepy things as making it beautiful and wonderful and perfect, and then maybe that's enough for the savvy viewer to be like, something's not right.
It's a magical place.
Oh!
We're agents of shit.
Wow.
Sorry.
I was not prepared for that.
I had to.
The small reference to another show?
That particular seemingly innocuous phrase that incapacitates an entire fandom on its own.
Anyway.
Yeah, I wasn't prepared
for that.
Before
we get the button that we're off topic.
Too late.
I don't want to get in trouble again. From an editorial standpoint, unfortunately, because of the time constraints, we've been getting a lot when our guests come on talking about scenes that get deleted.
Yes.
for the episode because of the time constraints, because we only got 40 minutes, but so much more ends up getting shot. How do you go about kind of that like fine tuning to get it into that time frame? Because you guys work very closely with the director and the producers on that, correct?
Oh yeah. Most of our episodes would time out between 55 to just under 60 minutes. So there is stuff that you have to lose. A great example of going nuclear last week, there was just a lot of walking in it. So that was easy to lose. It wasn't any character development or anything. In this case, the two main speeches with Helen and Addie, and actually with Mac too when they're sitting there, those were the areas that got trimmed up quite a bit. And in doing that, you really have to go in there with a fine scalpel, I like to call it, to analyze what they're saying and what's important and how to streamline. And I wish you would have been in the room with us at that time, because she's put a lot of energy and a lot of effort into what she's writing. And there might be threads that I wasn't even aware of. And I hope in this case, I didn't cut something out that connected to something else, because we really
do. The main line, the most important line in the whole
thing. And I trim it out, you know.
Yeah, no, there was not a main thing. But it was interesting because, but speaking of those big speeches that Helen had, because we cast Kelly McGillis like, pretty close to the beginning of production.
About three minutes before we started shooting.
And she flew in to Spokane from North Carolina, and her flight was delayed. So she basically got in at like 11 p.m. the night before she was supposed to start shooting. And we started on that day when she had one of those big long speeches. And so as soon as I got to the set, Jen, help me with this. And the thing is, with the script and everything that was written, it kind of put everything in, like you put all the emotional turns of the scene into the dialogue. But with an actress who's as talented, as skilled as Kelly, they don't need all of that. You know, someone like her, that she can do as much with like a look or one word that some actors might need three lines of dialogue to get across. But for her, as soon as you see her and you hear her start talking, you start to get who she is and what she's about. So, yeah, we didn't need all that dialogue.
Well, a great example is Rachel's scene in the first scene when they're sitting on that long table and they're talking between themselves. And then Rachel...
He's talking about the little girl Rachel.
Oh, yeah.
I was named after the director, I think.
Who is not named. I don't think you hear her name.
I don't know if you do or not, but
the little girl is
with
called
the tiny singing child.
Tiny singing child.
Helen's talking to her about men and how bad they are and being a man cutting the episode. It's kind of awkward. But we get to a certain point and the little girl comes in and she mentions her hair and talks to Addie about her hair and what the little pieces in the hair mean, and that plot point was to get to the necklace, where Helen says, well, what is this? Is this special to you? And we realized that that little beat of her coming in and saying that, it was just good enough for Helen to reach over and go, is this special for you? And it just connected it more to Helen and Addie as opposed to having the third character come in and set it up. So that's a slight little trim that we did, which will hopefully end up on DVD.
Here's hoping, because just from the sound of it, I would love to see a compilation of all the deleted scenes, because there's some pretty cool stuff by the sound of it that we don't get to.
There is, and all of the editors, you know, Fred and Anders, we all compiled those. As we took things out, we made a separate edit of just the deleted material along with the blooper reel material.
I want it.
So we're hoping that the people who are putting together the DVD, that they'll use all that, and all of us will get to see it, because that's a lot of work we did. Yeah. You did, you know, and we'd like it to be preserved in some fashion, so it would be great if it ends up on the DVD.
Here's hoping.
Is the blooper reel like 90% Mac dying?
Well, I didn't cut that episode, so, but there is a lot. There is a lot of stuff. They said there was some stuff cut out of that even. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, there's a lot of fun. There's a lot of fun stuff. Let's just say that.
All right. Well, sounds before like we go any further, I want to know, what was your guys' initial reaction when this episode ended? Because when this episode ended, I was very conflicted, because I really liked the premise, but the fact that it cost us, you know, not just one, but possibly two characters, and I don't think we're completely done with them yet, but just the fact that they could be gone for good.
Oh, my reaction, we're not done with them yet.
My reaction would be summed up with, what?
Pretty much. Well, I think when we heard that, oh, this is going to be an all-women one. Oh, hey, great, this will be cool. And you walk into it with a certain set of expectations, and then it winds up being like cult number 5 in this series. We're like, oh, dear God, it's another flavor of crazy. Who's going to get it this time?
I wasn't sure when I first saw it. It was like a compound of all women, like in the synopsis or whatever. I was like, this could go one of two very distinct directions, and I'm not sure which one SyFy is going for.
Yeah,
and it went that one.
Because I had the impression, again, with all-female compound, I had the impression that they were female vigilantes, and I kind of had and that's the thing, is they kind of are, but the way I had it in my mind was very romanticized. Like, you know, again, that spaghetti western kind of fun aspect of it that Z Nation has definitely had those beats in the past. But what we got was something a little bit darker, and I wasn't really expecting that.
I mean, just to compliment Jen and Carl for the episode, that's what I actually love, the moral complexity. Like, I love, because like 75% of the time, I'm on the side of these women. You know, like, yes, women
the
apocalypse is hard for women, and they're, you know, they're victimized and they're scared and they're, you know. And so, it feels like almost everything they do, you can legitimize, but then there's some things they do.
Like the zombie bear.
Like, what?
The term is zombie bear.
How did they catch it
in the first place? Where did this? How did they get it in there? Did they have the structure built? Did they lure it in with a guy to begin with and just keep it?
If you're gonna,
I want to know the logistics of the zombie bear.
If you're going to have a weird zombie way of killing people ritualistically, you might as well make it a zombie bear zombear.
Yes, I think that's all the explanation. One point I thought I was thinking of one line of explanation where Helen just says, my husband was a hunter. and that's all you get. But then I thought, no, the less you know, the better.
Yeah. I imagine they like found it in there, like it wandered in, like ate like a horse or something, and they're just like, just leave it. We'll find a use for it later.
Just you know, close the door. It could have been dying.
What's fun about the zombie bear is there was some talk, you know, with Carl and everybody coming in and out of the cutting room, and one conversation I overheard was, zombie bears are very scary, but just bears in general, why does it have to be a zombie bear? You know what I mean? Just a bear is scary to begin with. How it got in there, I know one thing that I asked for in terms of the bear is I really wanted to see the ribs. And I said, wouldn't it be great if his stomach was just like gutted out, you know, so he was like rotted away. So it could have been just an animal that just died naturally and then came back and then, like you said, probably went after something and got in there.
I think a zombie bear the official yeah, the official term. Word. A zombear is like a boss in a video game. Like that's like boss level because like you can't shooting it does nothing. It just will keep coming at you.
I just feel really bad that Roya's not here today because she was really looking forward to that bear.
She was very excited last week.
She's like, guys, I'm going to be useless next panel because every single word out of my mouth is just going to be bear, bear.
That's well, right.
And now she's not here, so we don't even get that. Roya, we miss you.
I can channel her. Bear.
Well,
bear. Bear.
Cannibalism. Bear.
I'm a guy with a Devil's Tower poster at home, and I missed last week's episode. Aww. So it works out, I guess, that way.
Bear.
but I do want to say, like, a compliment to the three of you guys on the, going back to what we were talking about with the cult versus, like, a sanctuary. Because it, like, I think a lot of cults would start out that way with, like, a good purpose to them. Like, there's something that they're building from, like, protection. Everybody needs somewhere to be safe. Mm-hmm. And then the one rule that is sort of keeping them safe, like, maybe if you bent it a little bit, it would be okay, but then it goes a step too far.
Mm-hmm. They send their 13-year-old sons out to die in the world under a lie.
It's like a sexist version of Logan's Run.
It kind of.
Yeah.
And this really stuck with me, and it was partially funny and partially just, ooh, this is rough. Right after the Zombear, where they're talking about, oh, men are evil, oh, men are terrible, and everyone in the crowd's like, yeah, you're right, they really are. There's this little 12-year-old boy just looking like, oh, God. That yeah, is gonna be me.
That was a bummer. It was like, and it's really weird that, you know, they're perfectly happy to accept Sam back in when the group drops him off, and then it's just the very end of the episode they just shoot, you know, send him out again, and you know he's not gonna make it to Salt
going
Lake
to
City.
See his dad.
Yeah. Yeah, his dad.
But were they really happy to see him? If you really watch Helen's performance, she's like, oh, Sam. I'm sure your mom will be very happy to see you.
Mom's gonna be happy.
They say they're happy to see him. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it kind of goes back to, you know, the price of peace, and is it really worth it?
Well, I can kind of see them coming from this, because Helen's made it very clear that she came from a religious, I suppose, situation. Not sure if it was supposed to be extreme Mormonism or just cultish and illegal and weird, because we're talking polygamy.
They're conceivably in Utah, so
I think the Mormon implication was pretty heavy.
It's pretty, yeah.
Well, polygamy is not a thing most Mormons do anymore, so that's...
No, they're,
anyway,
they're outside the FLDS.
It's the apocalypse. But it makes sense to have a backlash that bad from someone who got out of a situation like that. Yeah. It's like Scientologists who become born-again Christians. You go from one extreme that scares people to another extreme that scares people.
And again, like, that's the best written... And I don't want to call her a villain because she is kind of a little bit morally ambiguous.
Antagonist.
Or morally, yeah, there you go. The best antagonists are ones who have, you know, good, compelling reasons for doing what they're doing. So, you know, you can't just 100% vilify them, because you can understand where they're coming from. Well, that doesn't justify what they're doing.
The best villains believe that they are the heroes of their own stories.
Yep.
So, bear.
Yes.
See, look at what you started.
What have I done?
You've created
no regrets. Well,
before we go on, I want to talk to you guys really quickly about iTunes. Folks, thank you guys so, so much for everybody who goes to iTunes to rate and leave a comment. It really makes our day when we go and we see that somebody left a really nice, very, very wonderful comment. And we love hearing from you guys on YouTube as well. The people behind the scenes at AfterBuzz work over 90 hours a week to give you guys all of the content that we produce for free. So it really means the world when you go to iTunes and you rate and leave a comment, because that's the best way we can let them know that you like the show we're putting on.
Five stars, please. Tell us you love us.
Yeah, all that jazz.
And if you don't, lie to us.
And I don't have it here with me, but in the future, if you guys rate and comment and everything like that, we'd be more than happy to give you a shout on the show. It's always fun. So, yes. Thank you, guys. So let's talk about a couple different aspects of this episode, because for one, I was, although it was a little unsettling at first, I was really happy to see the band get back together again, because they've been apart for so long. And then to have it broken up so quickly, like one episode back together and then it's done.
Can you tell us a little more about the setting where they got back together? That compound and the person that they were supposed to meet with who was dead, it seemed like, okay, we've got them together. And then I was curious about that.
About what the location was supposed to be or what was happening.
He's there. Former CIA, right?
Yeah, I thought that the guy who died was going to figure into the story, like the sisters killed him to get supplies or something. I was looking for a connection where there might not have been one.
Initially, he was a character who was not dead.
Oh.
When you met him. In fact, we auditioned one man accidentally for part. That's another story.
Sorry, but, you don't get the part. He died.
But there was a big whole scene there where it's not only like an NSA, it's an NSA listening station inside a salt mine where all this media from all, you know, generations is kept.
So it was basically another version of Citizen Z.
Yeah, he's stuck in there and he has supplies. He has food. He has a vehicle. You know, that was originally how they got the vehicle. But then that episode would have been an hour and a half long. So
I would have watched that TV program.
Yeah. So it's so it was sort of condensed that Chester had already met his doom. But they found supplies, which was a scene that was cut out. Yep. But they found supplies and they connected with Citizen Z and found out that the lab was back on in California. So
yeah, and that's the most important.
That was the main plot point that we needed from there. So that's what I left.
Because we had left it a couple episodes ago where the fate of California was kind of left ambiguous. We were left in the dark about that. So it's kind of nice to know, assuming that Citizen Z isn't hallucinating again, that their end goal is still intact. Because go ahead.
Hasn't it been ambiguous since episode 2?
The end goal or the...
Whether or not California was still a functional thing.
I want to say it was like episode 3 or 4. But
it sort of dropped off for a little while. So then it was, we're going because what other option do we have?
Yeah.
And then...
he says, we're back online.
We're back online.
Yeah.
We're good.
Let's go. We're on the mission.
More gas leaks. He's on track.
It's very nice to have that because, you know, just everything they've gone through to get to this point, you kind of need that re-energized, oh, good, there is still
this
that light at the end of
nothing.
The tunnel.
Yeah.
Yeah. At least for now. I can't wait to see what happens when they actually get to California. But
me too.
Me three. Will they get to California? Let's find out.
Well, supposedly there's a 5-year plan for the show, so
yes, there is.
And they better get to California before then.
I hope so. Well, they're already in Utah,
exactly.
So I don't think it'll take them that much longer.
We get to California. The scientists all left and went to Mexico. I don't know.
LA's a jungle, man.
Something about Tijuana.
That's amazing.
Evidently, drinking the water makes you immune to the virus. We didn't need Murphy at all.
Hey, tequila's.
That would have been a really funny twist.
Eating the worm, it cures the zombie apocalypse.
Da, 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 da. That's why only frat boys survive.
And in reaction, we have an all-women colony who kills men on sight.
All right. Which, although, one of those ladies was giving Murphy all sorts of googly eyes. This was probably one of the funniest things I've seen from Murphy in this show was this one lady just totally being smitten with Murphy, leaving her post to go and essentially be a booty call and give him pie.
She wants to do is give him pie, both kinds of pie.
Every kind of pie.
She snuck out. They make the point later, how did she get out? Like, well, she
followed her heart, you guys.
She followed her
heart.
This was, right after 10K going, a colony full of women. I wonder what that's like. Doc telling him your imagination's all you're going to get. And then her coming out, where's the one with the hair and the eyes? And, you know, the hair and the eyes. Oh, it's 10K. It's that
when
kid.
She said,
no, that guy.
Yeah, when she said the hair, I thought she was going for 10K. I was like, oh, this is going to be fun.
Oh, good. That worked. That worked. You know, that was.
I think 10K thought she was going for 10K.
You know what's so funny? That was a visual effect when she glances over and she sees 10K and. Murphy had already climbed into the tent, so I'm like, well, I need Murphy climbing, so I split the shot in half, and then we tie we basically changed the timing on both of them to make it so that it was kind of a misdirect. You know, you guys saw 10K, but if you really look, Murphy's going into the tent, and that's why she knew where to go.
And just kind of historically speaking on the show, 10K is the one that always has the crush of the week.
Yeah.
And to just see her walk right by him and go make a beeline to Murphy, it was pretty hilarious.
I thought for sure Murphy was going to bite her. When she had her finger in his mouth and was doing all the whatever daddy wants stuff, I thought for sure that she was going to get bitten.
Well, something worse might have happened.
Yeah, zombie baby, Mark II.
Mm-hmm. Or her tummy hurt from too much pie, you guys.
Exactly.
It could go either way.
She was just going, oh.
What was in that pie? That... I should know. I made it.
She made it herself.
I mean, she did. Feeling her stomach like an hour later. I don't think zombie sperm are that effective.
A woman knows.
Oh, spoiler alert here. Yeah. But you know what's interesting? Who was the actress that played that?
Sarah Coates.
I mean,
so good.
Didn't she do a
Sarah
great
Coates.
Job?
Yeah.
And for me, cutting that scene, I had to shut my door. Because, you know, imagine all of the dailies. It was just that noise coming out. And people were walking by and kind of stopping,
like,
going, what's
going
on in there?
Is your editor listening to something inappropriate?
Exactly. It was a little embarrassing. I said, God, what, all of a sudden I'm cutting a porn. What's going on here? Because, you know, all the heavy breathing and the pie comments and everything. But it was one of my favorite scenes to cut.
Yeah, it
was
really.
Well, yeah, I mean, Sarah's a terrific actress. I mean, she came into an audition and we actually were debating which role we should cast
her
in.
Can she be everything?
We were like, can we put her in a wig so she can be this other one? And she just had the best comedic timing. And
really
just
good.
Were like, it was weird and kind of sexy and funny. And it's like, what's going on? And as I said to David Latt, one of our producers, I was like, that's for the European market, because apparently we need more sex for the European market, but how do you get more sex in a zombie show? And it's that.
Well, you take a hard left turn into HBO. That's
yeah.
I think it was Abram who mentioned the last time you were on the show that, like, this show is kind of about sexually frustrating its characters. And
yeah, he does have that theory.
Out of all this time, Murphy's the one that gets laid.
And he didn't die right afterwards.
Like in normal horror movies.
Yeah. Or in this show.
That's right. He did survive the sexual encounter.
Yeah. Then again, he wasn't considerate enough to eat out. So.
We didn't. At least that we saw. You don't know.
There's a lot that happened in the tent.
When they come back and they're like, "Where's Murphy?" And he's like, "He's still in there with that girl." So
couldn't get her to leave.
I don't think Murphy knows how, nor does he care to learn. He's not that kind of guy.
I do love though that they open up the tent and they're both smoking cigarettes, and the question is, where did you even get those?
Whatever daddy wants.
Also, like a tent, the worst place to smoke a cigarette. But you're not going to want to smoke a cigarette
dangerous.
In a tent.
That is not well ventilated.
Did she just have those in her pockets? Or somewhere else?
A pocket.
Well, what, was
lots,
there a little?
Lots of pockets in the overall.
Yeah.
Well, was there a little thing with them lighting it up and before the scene? Were they in there, you know, with a lot of smoke? Or was there anything fun?
No,
happened.
It wasn't supposed to. It was always just supposed to be that one moment where they open the tent and there he is with the cigarette.
But then he made
just
more.
A gag,
yeah,
know?
And he made more of it though. He's just like puffing away on that thing.
Although I do have to wonder about the outtakes for that particular scene, because she is so funny. Like, I wonder if Keith Allen was able to keep a straight face.
It's funny, but it's also like we've like shot that scene, you know. 20 minutes, like we had no time, so it's not like, oh, we were just doing takes and laughing and like, you know, it was here we go, we're rolling.
Business as usual.
Yeah. It was a quickie.
And it was our camera guy like in
the tent.
Yeah,
there was
they were
a
like,
lot of like on the monitor, it was a lot of like people's butts because they're like diving, you know, trying to get
trying
the shot
get in.
Inside
the boom
tent.
Guy, yeah, or, yeah. I don't know if this is an inappropriate story, but the boom guy was trying to get his boom in and the camera, or the DP after said that like his testicles were like being massaged by the boom pole. Like, He's like, I didn't know what to do, so he just kept rolling. But like,
I mean, and I think
that scene was uncomfortable for a lot of people. Just say that
he is a consummate professional.
And I think that's it. You guys were shooting it so fast, and the characters had to be on mark with
the
performances. That there wasn't any like cracking up, but what there was is improv. There was a chance to feed off of each other, and they did such a great job feeding off each other that there is stuff on the editing room floor, because the scene would have been twice as long, so I had to chop it down to just get it right to the right performance. So there is stuff there, but it's more character than
extended Cinemax cut.
Exactly.
Then it would have been 60 minutes and HBO. Just a 60 minute episode. Yep.
The Showtime version. Not
yeah,
the
20 minutes
version.
Of pie. And then the rest,
20
yeah.
minutes of pie.
And then some zombie stuff.
Why didn't we start this episode with cherry pie?
That would have been great.
Because they were eating blueberry pie.
Oh, there's thought, not okay.
I thought she meant actual pie.
No, yeah, I was like, bring. Do we have some?
Yes, pie would be great. Two, no, I mean the song. Three, the song that I know about blueberry pie is for children.
Anyway, all I wanted, I just want to stop at Marie Callender's now on the way home.
I know.
Anyway,
let's do it.
Anyway,
is that one of the sponsors?
I do. Yeah. No, they're really not.
They are now,
but I will be going there anyway. But I really want to talk about Addie in this episode, because she is a huge focal point in this episode, and it was kind of fascinating to watch her progression in this, because she starts off the episode with that really creepy Cinderella dressed in yellow nursery rhyme as she's killing zombies, and just kind of watching her get seduced by this place.
That's a good word.
That is exactly what it was. And Helen was seducing her to stay, you know, with all the promises of you can finally rest. You don't have to worry about anything. You are smart and capable. And, you know, we could use someone like you, and you can finally get some rest and peace of mind, which in the zombie apocalypse, of course, those promises aren't true.
No.
But they sound amazing after you've been on the road for so long.
And my question about that for all of you guys is, we know that Addie is in a really rough place at the moment. Does Helen know, and is she preying on her to get her to stay here? Is she manipulating her? Or is she genuinely offering what she thinks is compassion?
A little column A, a little column B.
She thinks that her mission is right, so she's not tricking her in that way, but I think she certainly has a sixth sense for someone who's vulnerable. So it's like,
exactly.
Took her 3 seconds of assessing. You know, she has that kind of personality, like sees them
when Addie and Warren and Cassandra were walking in, she's like, you're not like the other ones. You're special. Whereas your special may be code for, I can take advantage of your fragile mental state at the moment.
Yeah, she knows if she tried to do that to Warren, she'd get punched in the face. Like, Warren's not taking any of that. But she can see the emotional hurt that Addie's going through.
Well, especially when where she finds the weakness is in the necklace.
Mm-hmm.
When she mentions that, and then the breakdown, and and it was great to watch as the actress, you know, she really fed off of Addie's performance, and to see her react the way she did, for me in the cutting room, was just like, when I saw that in the dailies, I was moved in the dailies. How was it on the set, you know, watching those two act? I mean, they're both great actors, and to watch them do that scene.
Yeah, Kelly definitely brought a lot. I mean, I think that it is... Like, Helen is moved by that story. This is why she believes that they exist. You know, so when she's hearing about Addie's trials and tribulations, it's like, of course, that's horrible. That's why you need to be here.
Away from men.
Yeah,
away from men. Testosterone's the most dangerous chemical on earth.
That was a really funny line.
Such a good line.
Yeah. But
just the
I'm saying I'm like, that's a good line because Carl wrote that line. So I'm not like going, I wrote a great line. Yeah.
Well, I'm switching to a different moment in the episode, so if you have
I was going to say, just because you touched on Warren wouldn't take any of that, it was very frustrating watching the reins taken out of Warren's control, and you can see it in her eyes and in her performance that she knows she's losing a grip on the situation and that it's going to cost her. But she's still doing everything she can to try to hold on to it anyway. And that was really frustrating to watch, because you're like, you're Warren! You can handle anything!
It was interesting seeing, actually, the parallels to early experiences and earlier episodes written in here. Because we have Cassandra telling her, look, I know it feels good, you feel safe. That's how I felt when I fell in with the cannibal crew, and you can see how that turned out. Don't do the thing, it's bad. And then Helen talking to Addie about, well, yes, you love him very much, but eventually he's going to die and then you'll have to give him mercy. It's like, wait, we've seen this. This has been a thing. That's, well, I'll have to give him mercy. Yeah, that's what Warren had to do with Garnett, and she got better. So it's not the be-all, end-all of the world here.
And plus, again, oh, go ahead.
Oh, that's just like, it's a crazy mindset. Like, yeah, we're all going to die at some point, but it's about the in-between.
Yeah, exactly. Just because you could make that argument about anything in real life, not just in the zombie apocalypse. Mm-hmm. Just, well, we're going to die, so what's the point? You know, you can use that to argue just about anything.
You'll probably get cancer in 20 years.
Exactly.
But coming from the place of if someone had just died of cancer, like, you know, she's the right person to hear that message.
And that's a great point. Yeah, that she had suffered so much. She was just done.
Yeah. And the other thing that you mentioned, you know, Warren having to do that with Garnett, Warren can understand because she even remarks, she's like, I've been there. I know where she's at. She's in a really dark place, and it's not an easy place to come back from. Especially, and, you know, to Warren's credit, she was able to get over it on her own, but they left her alone to do that and to overcome that. There wasn't anybody standing, you know, apart from the bartender, he ended up dying. There wasn't anybody there trying to convince her otherwise. You know, she was able to work through it on her own. And I wonder if Addie had just been left on her own to work through it, if maybe none of this would have happened.
Mm-hmm. Mac never would have left her alone.
Fair enough.
he's a little needy, huh?
A little bit.
You don't say.
Well, but also I would say not. Yes, I wouldn't say he's needy. He's protective.
Yeah.
And he knows that she is in a state where she needs protecting.
Mm-hmm. He also seems to have pinned both his survival and his sanity on her. Mm-hmm. Like, she is his, to bring this phrase back, be all and end all. And if she's not around or if she's dead, well, then what's the point? He seems to revolve entirely around her. And when she's removed from the situation, he doesn't know what to do.
To the point where he abandons the group again. You know, he...
And is now Schrodinger's character.
Is he alive?
Alive and dead at the same time.
Well, and we saw that from the beginning, too, when they got separated in the first place. He was willing to abandon them if it meant saving him and Addie. So, you know, it makes perfect sense that he would jump right out of that car again.
So. I'd be that way.
After being shot.
Yeah.
After being shot, yeah.
But I'd be that way. I mean, like you said, it's the apocalypse. If this is what you consider your life partner, you know, I mean, where do you go? And also leaving them to a place that you know is not what it is. I mean, think of that, too. It is not what it is. I mean, zombie bear. You know?
Yeah,
Well, that, and they left for a little bit, and he's like, Addie would never leave me behind. I was like, she kind of just did. Mm-hmm. And that's when we have Addie straight up murder somebody. Because it's one thing, you know, in self-defense. This was a guy who was tied up, who's like, I'm not even with these guys. And Helen was able to convince her to go ahead and kill him. And that was probably the darkest moment that we've seen for Addie so far.
Oh, by far. I mean, when she had to mercy her mother and her brother, like, those were zombies. Like, kill or be killed. Like, they're not even really themselves anymore. This is just a guy, a kid. Yeah. And you really saw the twisted side of the Sisters of Mercy.
I kind of was picturing Warren as like the little angel on her shoulder and Helen as like the little devil. Like, do it. No, it's not right.
Well, do you want to talk about that? Because that was an interesting scene for all of us.
Yeah, I mean, we spent a lot of time talking about that. And I think part of the reason, go which way is cause and effect, but Carl happens to know a lot about cults.
That is both intriguing and terrifying.
But Carl knows a lot about everything, so I'm not sure if that's just a particular knowledge set that works for our show. But the whole point of that scene was that, you know, it's you draw people into a cult with like, oh, it's going to be nice. You can rest. You can do all these things, like Helen is saying to Addie, and then it comes a point where people are pushed to make a psychological leap. And that's what that Helen convincing Addie to shoot this guy is you make this leap, sort of a leap across a chasm that you can't come back from. And the only way you can sort of psychologically deal with making that leap, like killing someone in cold blood, is to believe the whole philosophy of the cult. Yeah. Because the only way you doing that is right is if the world follows the rules that these people are telling you.
If you question that decision too much, it means that you're bad. Whereas if you stand behind the decision you made, then you get to be safe and good in your mind still.
Yeah. Well, and just
a terrifying amount of sense.
Just a couple episodes ago, we had, you know, a group in a cult that were murdering innocent people and very much justifying it to themselves, even though the people were begging for mercy like this guy was. That was a straight up kind of villainous move on her part. And now she's stuck with them.
And not only did she kill a guy, she like then tortures the others.
Yeah.
Which, like, granted, they might deserve like a certain amount of torture. The original two who were like holding the women captive, but
tied up in the sidecar.
That's some sadistic stuff.
Yeah. And I was surprised actually that guy was able to get away for a whole like 2 seconds before Max shot him.
But what's interesting also about that scene is they were already left. Director's cut was done, and now it's producer's cut, and we still hadn't cracked. We still didn't believe that Addie would kill. I mean, this is a big moment for us in the show.
Yeah.
And we need to believe that Addie would do this. And I had already suggested to Rachel about the having a flash of the cannibal scene. Going into it, because, you know, this was an episode that didn't have a lot of zombies, so it's a great way to add just a little zombie beat that we've already seen but kind of changed up a little bit, and it leads us perfectly into the scene. You survive that. How horrible is that? So it kind of flashed. So that was kind of put in during why we were filming, actually, I think. And so now here we are, we're in the producer's cut, and we still were struggling with her being brainwashed enough to do this. And it's like, well, since we already did that, why don't we pull some more out of that episode and then add some additional lines? And this was all Carl was in the room with me, and he's the one. I just became the fingers at that point. We knew where we had to go to try to make it work that Addie would shoot him, but Carl really knew. He really helped structure the edit. And how the gunshot goes off in the dark, and then we come back in slow-mo. And that was all Carl figuring that out with me. And that was one of the fun moments with me being with Carl, the show creator on the show, and watching him work. And like you said, he does know so much in putting that together. So that was a great experience for me in the cutting room. And I'm glad it worked out for you on the show, because, you know, that's the ultimate thing. Will this work? It worked for us in the cut. Because we then sent it to you, and then you signed off on it, and then to see you guys react to it, it's like, yay!
And it doesn't match, because what Helen says to Addie was actually not scripted. Oh. But what Kelly said to Anastasia was basically that, like, remember the cannibals.
Yeah.
Remember, I mean, you could probably hear that.
I think I did hear a little bit of that.
On the production track,
yeah.
But that, so that kind of came from her.
Wow.
Because, I mean, she's, you know, doing the work of an actor and going, well, what am I saying to her to get her to do this? And it's like, remember your brother, remember, you know, all
yeah,
this,
that was it. I remember her whispering that, brother, slightly yeah. hearing that in the track, yeah. Remember her brother. And we had shown, it's so funny that the episode kind of, in terms of her arc, Addie's arc, kind of came together through the past episodes and through the great writing that you had done, that it was very easy when she freezes and we cut to her brother or, mm-hmm. you know, talking about the cannibal. So it really came together kind of organically for us.
And it really did. It really did come together, and everything seemed to tie up very, very well. And we are running short on time, but I want to get into predictions a little bit. If that's all right.
Oh, you want us to step out of the room?
No, you just have to, like, blinders
face,
on.
Just poker face, just like,
how good is your poker face?
Very good.
I'm lucky to know very little, so.
Yeah, I'm the one I have to just
go. Yeah, and I also killed off Garnett, so I had to keep that, quiet for a long time.
So be careful. If he's cutting an episode,
we're losing character. So we got a preview for next week, and it looks like Murphy's like at some sort of golf country club.
We could say yes.
Okay. Yes, he is at a golf country.
Yes,
it looks like he got picked up by this whole other band of people somehow. Like maybe he has a falling out with his crew, and this other crew goes, "Oh, we'll take you to California." Oh, sure, I'm mad at them. I'll go with you, and then lo and behold, we ain't going to California.
Yeah, it's like no. But my big question at the end, and I think it's the question on probably most viewers' mind, is are Mac and Addy gone from the show for good?
No.
And yeah, I don't believe that for a second.
It's comic book rules. No body, no death. And this has been a series that has been completely unafraid to be like, look at them. Now they're dead. Now they're a zombie. Now they're dead again.
Look at the main character. He took a bullet for Murphy. He got shot. He's a zombie. And now he's shot in the head and he's dead.
Look at this guy. You thought he was the main character, and then a zombie baby ate him. And you get to see that. This is not a show that shies away from, look at all the dead people.
Well, maybe so, we did see it, and we didn't decide to show it.
Well, I figure by not showing it, it's left to be ambiguous. Zach, what do you think?
Yeah, I'm not willing to... I don't know how Mac gets out of that situation, because, like...
He was already shot, and he's running back into it, and he's running back into a closed door.
And like it's Mac and Addy, because you've got the little girl, the Rachel, the not you, Rachel, carrying the necklace.
Well, and she's saying some kind of weird version of Agatha Christie's, you know, novel. There's that little nursery rhyme, and then there were none. And she's kind of doing a little butterfly version of that while holding the necklace.
What if Addy, like, got up onto the hill and is like, they're shooting at Mac, and, like, takes her Z-Wack and just, like, kills, like, all the women up on... And then they run away.
Just take notes.
I think those final shots would have been very different if that were the case.
With how unhinged she was at the beginning of this episode, I kind of figured that if she was going to meet her end anytime soon, it would be kind of a kamikaze frenzy type thing where she was just going to go into a no-win situation and just fight her way until she couldn't fight anymore.
Which is what Mac did.
They throw Mac in with the zombear. She realizes she doesn't want him to die like that and goes in with the zombear with him. Aww. My God, he's Jamie Lannister.
What if they tame the zombear and become a traveling circus of Mac, Addy, and the zombear?
For three OxyContin. Yeah.
Watch the zombie bear ride a ball.
Bear.
I'm just going to say, I don't know if this is too much of a spoiler, but I think the last maybe 30 seconds of the show or whatever those last cuts are all there for a reason.
Mm-hmm. All right. That's a very good way of putting it.
Rewatch.
That's a very good way of putting it. Well, we are running short on time. I believe there's another show after us, so we don't get to go longer like we normally do. I was hoping, do you guys have any final thoughts on like how it was working on this episode and just the series in general?
It was a real pleasure for me. I'm like, oh, everyone's looking at me.
Well, Rachel.
I'm the only one in the room who only worked on this episode. It was awesome. It was actually really cool. And I feel very lucky to have gotten this episode in particular because there were just a lot of, I got the feminist cult episode with a bunch of emotional, like, important emotional beats.
Yeah.
So it was a pleasure and very challenging. I don't know how much you guys have heard about, but how fast we shoot and how crazy
super fast
it is.
Yeah.
It's probably the craziest. I've worked on a lot of low budget things. It's probably the craziest schedule.
Did we shoot 14 pages on the last day or something?
It was crazy.
It was crazy. It's really, really but fast. It was. But we ended up getting lucky with a lot of stuff on this episode too. Like getting Kelly with the locations, with Little Brook, the green paradise.
Yeah, I love all our locations.
But then it was a railroad right of way that went through that sort of stone canyon that we like randomly found driving around. Outside of Spokane, and got really lucky with that, and then our production designer turned it into the gate and everything. So it was really hard work and a lot of fun this episode.
And for me it was performance. I mean, I was cutting zombies, how many zombie deaths have I done, and this episode focused on performance, and I really enjoyed cutting that.
I agree. I think it was a lot of fun, a lot of really good stuff in this episode. Where can fans go if they want to find out more about you guys and the work that you're doing?
Well, for me, it's very easy. Synergy Films in Focus, filmsinfocus.com, Films in Focus on YouTube, and of course, Films in Focus on Twitter. So very easy to find me.
And rlgoldenberg@gmail.com. is my email, but I meant to say rlgoldenberg.com is my website. My email's on there, so you can still email me.
Oh, wow. You're going to have a lot of fans.
I still don't have a website, but you can follow me on Twitter at Jen Elder, J-E-N-L-D-E-R.
Nice. Zach, where can the people find you?
So you can follow me on Twitter at ThatZachWilson, ThatZachWilson. And also here at AfterBuzz, whole bunch of shows. It's like some weeks are on and off. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Sleepy Hollow, Grimm, lots of stuff. Thanks for tuning in, guys.
I'm Katie Cullen. You can find me on Twitter and Tumblr at Kiaxet. That's K-I-A-X-E-T. I am also on Sword Art Online, Star Wars Rebels, and Arrow, which is taking a break this week, but next week is the big crossover.
And you can follow Roya at Hey Roya on Twitter. And you can follow
Instagram.
Oh, and Instagram?
I think so, yeah.
Cool. And you can follow me on Twitter at TheMenguin. That's T-H-E-M-E-N-G-U-I-N. I'm also on a bunch of shows here at AfterBuzz. Yeah, which may or may not be on this week.
Yeah.
But folks, thank you so much for tuning in. And thank you again to our wonderful guests for joining us tonight. It was a pleasure having you on the show.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
Thank you.
So fun.
Of course. Thank you guys.
Thanks for watching.
We will see you guys next week.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.